Welcome to another Rocky Mountain Sasquatch Organization Roundtable Drive. We're driving up the Grand Mesa, looking at Bigfoot sighting hotspots. There's a lot of Bigfoot sightings on the Mesa and around the base of the Mesa. And we've yet to do a roundtable drive on any of our expeditions till now. So we thought we'd show you guys what the drive on top of the Mesa looks like. And we're just starting at the base. Yeah, we were just by the Colorado River.
Yeah, the last time we were here, it was fall, and all the trees were yellow and orange and red. It's really pretty.
Yep.
There should be quite a bit of snow when we get up there this time.
Yeah, there's the Powderhorn Ski Resort close by, and then the top of this Grand Mesa is a popular snowmobile area this time of year. And one of the reasons we wanted to come here in the wintertime is so we could look around for Bigfoot tracks in the snow. I have a feeling, though, that it probably comes down lower out of the snow in the wintertime, but you never know. Never know where they're going to be.
It could be on the fringe.
I feel like Bigfoot, just like the elk, they like to stay right on the edge of where the snow is at whatever time of the year it is.
Yeah, common sense would tell you that an animal that large and hairy would be at the temperature that is most comfortable for its body. Not real cold, not real hot. So wherever they need to find that at the time of season.
And if they're into eating game, wherever the game's comfortable at.
Yep.
What I like about when we spot game is that game is there for a reason. Comfort levels, obviously, food and
water.
And say, for instance, the argument, which I doubt, that Bigfoot may not be a big-time meat eater. It's got to eat, you know, nuts, berries, vegetation, so it could be in the very same area eating what the game eats. I think it eats both. I think it eats the game and also eats what the game eats. Most of the Bigfoot sighting reports I know of are actually on the top of the Mesa, but there are several Bigfoot sightings that are down at the base of the Mesa, like in Montrose, Grand Junction. There's two Montrose Bigfoot sightings I know of, and then one in Grand Junction. So they obviously travel to the top and back down to the bottom of the Mesa for whatever reason.
I wonder if he goes down and gets grapes.
Yeah, there's a vineyard down there.
There's
the
vineyards
bottom.
Everywhere. Lots of rivers and lakes up here as well. And the last time we were up here, there was a lot of fish in those little lakes up there.
There's several hundred lakes on the top of the Grand Mesa, and a lot of them are so close that if you're into lake fishing, you get sick of one lake, you just
walk over to the other one.
You walk a quarter of a mile and you're on a new lake.
there's some deer in that field right there.
Yes, there is.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Maybe the camera will pick up at least one of them. I doubt it. I think the camera's sitting too low.
Oh, he's got a nice rack.
That's too bad we can't pull over here.
No, there's nowhere to pull over.
The only way to pull over was onto that guy's private property.
And it said, no trespassing.
Yeah, the deer were eating on his property, too.
That's a nice piece of property right along the river in this canyon.
I forget the name of this river. We actually came from where it meets up with the Colorado a little ways back.
There's a bunch of mallards down there. There's gonna be baby ducks soon.
We were on the Green River a lot earlier this morning, and we saw a few flock of geese taking off from the Green River.
We've seen antelope today as well. There's supposed to be a bunch of moose in here, but I've never seen one.
Yep. I see moose warning signs all over the place and yet to see a moose. There's also a lot of elk crossing signs.
Deer. Well, we've seen deer. Of course, we've only ever been here once, and now this time as well. Maybe we'll see something this time. This reminds me of southern and eastern Utah.
Like 10 or 11,000 feet. Between 10 and 11,000, it's supposedly one of the largest mesas in North America. Or tallest, excuse me, not largest, tallest. So yeah, you go from the valley floors about 5,000 feet, and you work your way up to 11,000 feet. Or 10,000 feet to the top. I believe there's some peaks and stuff up there over 11,000 feet. But yeah, we're into high desert type stuff right now. And by the time we get near the top of this mesa, we'll be in alpine.
Lots of aspens up here, too.
It's just beautiful.
We'll be able to see farther back into the forest this time.
Yeah. When we came here in the fall, I was just like, yeah, we got to come back in the winter and see what this is all about. High desert areas like this, I noticed there's Bigfoot sightings in the fall and the winter time in places like that. Like, for instance, Dry Fork Canyon, at the mouth of that canyon, that's a high desert, and there was a Bigfoot sighting on Christmas Day several years ago.
There was one last year, just outside of our canyon.
Sasquatch Canyon, Utah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the same kind of terrain as well.
That's amazing. Some of these high desert areas, you'll get some of these slot canyons, and the entire slot canyons like alpine, you know, so you got these alpine slot canyons mixed in with the high desert, so you got a lot of habitats coming together in places like this. So an animal living in these areas, it can benefit from whatever's going on in each habitat different times of year. Came in from the Dubuque side the last time, and then come back off the Mesa this way, I think.
Yeah, we did. It's Plateau Creek.
All right.
What we've been following.
Good to know. Apologize, I don't know the geology that made this mesa. I know the Rocky Mountains used to be, a lot of the Rocky Mountains used to be under the sea and an inland ocean, and over 70 million years they've become the Rocky Mountains, so that's about as much of the geology I know about the Grand Mesa right now. I apologize, I'm here looking for Bigfoot. But it is amazing that the 10, 11,000 foot mesa formed here.
There it is. There's not a lot of snow. That's good.
Not as I envisioned, much more snow because of how much we've gotten at home and Idaho and everything. So I had it in my head that this was just going to be wall-to-wall snow here.
We should be able to get back in farther than I thought.
Yep. We may have more opportunities. Why we just can't write places off in the wintertime. Kind of got to go poke around a little bit. Plus we get bored staying at home all winter, so get cabin fever and we got to come do one of these. This is the big town of Mesa.
It's rocking.
I bet you during the summertime this place rocks.
Yeah, they got coffee and beer and breakfast, lunch, and dinner place. It's good enough.
Yeah.
Farmland that goes straight up into forest.
I just only know of the stories I've dug up on the internet, and then there's also been a few people that have emailed me their Bigfoot sighting reports in the area. I do know in Montrose, at the base of the Grand Mesa, some people had a window peeking Bigfoot one night, and they lived kind of out in the farm fields at the base of the Mesa.
I seem to recall you telling me a story about some kids getting watched by a babysitter and they tried to come in through the door. Was that here?
I don't know. I'd have to refresh myself on the report. I don't know if that's the same window peeking Bigfoot. Sorry. Been up here. The last time we come up here, I read all the reports before we came up, and this time I did not. I was thinking, oh, I've already read those. But obviously, I need to read them each time I go.
Well, we didn't decide to leave until last night.
Uh-huh. Yeah, this is a spur-of-the-moment expedition. I just saw that the conditions here were supposed to be 10 to 15 degrees warmer than at home.
Okay.
In the valleys below. It isn't going to be warmer on the top of this mesa. Something's got my allergies going. Wow. Right where the snow line starts up. Something's blooming right at the snow line because I can feel my spring allergies. We might be able to do more hiking than I thought.
That's what I'm saying.
Yay. We have got so much snow at home, and then it just snowed again a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, this is 300. Well, we've driven 380 miles from home.
Yeah.
Well, this is 380 miles from home. I was, for some reason, thinking that they would have the same stuff as we do, and it definitely will get deeper the higher we get on this mesa, though.
Yeah, but still, you can't even see the color of the earth where we live. It's just a white smock.
Yep. Saw 21 acres of property for sale. Hey, if you're watching this, Mark Crooks, 21 acres of property here for sale at the bottom of the mesa. He's looking to buy himself some property and build a house near or in a Bigfoot sighting area, so.
Yeah, he wants bigs in his backyard.
I don't blame him. I picked my property. I want bigs in the backyard, too. I think he wants to be more in the Idaho, Montana area. But he has said that he's willing to live in northern Utah. And I've also heard him talk about Missouri, too, so... Yeah, when you start getting that far east, I really don't know much about the Bigfoot sighting reports there. I don't study them because that's not where we go, so I couldn't even tell you any Bigfoot sightings in Missouri. I study the West Coast, Rocky Mountains, Pacific Northwest. But if you have a Bigfoot sighting, and you want to send us your report, and whether you want to be anonymous, or do you want your name attached to your report, let us know, because we'll keep you anonymous if that's what you want to do. The sighting report's really important to us. It helps us learn about the creature, even if it's outside of the area we do our expeditions. We'd still like to hear about them.
Yeah, they're so interesting and fun to read.
Here's Powderhorn. Okay, this is starting to look more like home.
Yeah. A couple weeks ago, we were just driving up over... The Bear Lake area into Idaho.
You guys will actually see the Bear Lake one before you see this one. So if you haven't seen the Bear Lake one, look back in the videos a little ways and you'll see the Bear Lake one.
We'll see what deep snow really looks like.
This looks like it has the potential to get pretty deep here on the top.
That's true.
It may be just as deep as the top of Bear Lake, up over the passes in and out of that lake. Yeah, I hope you guys appreciate these roundtable drives. It gives you guys a lot broader view of what the entire Bigfoot sighting area is. And then it also gives us the opportunity to have a camera rolling in case we get a road crosser.
Plus, we're usually yapping about this, that, or the other thing that has to do with Bigfoot.
Yeah. I see snow this deep and I'm just like, why would any animal want to stay within the snow line when it's this deep? It just looks miserable. But there's been a lot of Bigfoot sightings where the creature's been in this snow this deep. As a matter of fact, there was one guy that spotted a Bigfoot as he was flying over the Uinta Mountains in the wintertime in his light aircraft, and he circled back around it to make sure that's what it was that he saw trekking through the snow. And it was obvious to him both times he buzzed it that it was a two-legged animal and it was doing really well. I'm sure having a very large foot helps it stay up in the snow like snowshoes.
Long legs don't help. I mean, long legs help.
Uh-huh.
It's like moose.
Yeah, you'll see the moose in the deep snow and stuff sometimes too, and you're like, what the heck?
Yeah, they don't seem to have a problem.
The moose can eat pine needles and stuff, though, so they don't have to go rooting around and finding the stuff under the snow. They can just walk up to the pine trees and eat the pine needles. You know, and I've even heard other people mention, you know, we don't know all that Bigfoot can eat. Just, you know, as far as we know, it could go up and munch pine needles too. That would open up a lot more territory for the creature if it had a diet that diverse.
Yeah, had a gut that actually can digest that. That would be really helpful.
Uh-huh, and with its... A lot of people talk about its midsection's kind of big and barreled. I mean, maybe it does have more than one stomach. I know the Paul Freeman Bigfoot seemed to have a big barreled stomach area. It looked like Homer Simpson, his profile.
He sure did. We can drink pine needle tea. That's about it.
Uh-huh. And what kind of pines are you supposed to use of that? The pinyon pines, I hear, are some of the best.
The long needled.
Uh-huh. Vitamin C.
Vitamin C. Bear Grylls calls it vitamin C.
So did Ruth. On Mike and Ruth on Man, Woman, Survivor.
I love that show.
Yeah, they were funny together.
Peace off!
Yes. Yeah, I think they lasted 2 seasons. And they didn't quit because of ratings. They had good ratings. Ruth had enough after being life-flighted out of those places a couple of times.
Well, she just had a baby and she said she was responsible for more than herself now. She couldn't just be out risking her life all the time.
Yeah. Yeah, she got dehydrated a few times and heat stroke.
She's a trooper, though. I've seen her eat things that I wouldn't even put in my mouth.
Yep. I like how she gets a campsite ready, how she starts poking around in every nook and cranny for insects with her knife before they set up a camp. I was like, hey, that's a good idea. Get all the creepy crawlies. But look how fast everything changed with the altitude or elevation of this plateau. We're in big time alpine area now.
Yeah, maybe we can't.
Well, if we do a hike, we're going to have to do it at the edge of the snow line.
Yeah, we're going to have to go down a little bit.
We'll be able to find a place to hike these 2 days we're here. But I wanted to show off the top of this mesa in the wintertime up here, and then we can stop at a few places like we just did just back there and look for tracks in the snow. See if we can spot anything Bigfoot shaped going through the snow. Cross-country skiers. Yeah, they try and open it up for the recreationers so the people with snowmobiles and cross-country skis can get up here and enjoy the top of the mesa.
A lot of ours just get shut down.
Yeah, they don't leave passes in Utah this high open. They just shut them down for the wintertime. Yeah, one of our favorite Bigfoot places, Monte Cristo, sits about 9,500 feet, and they shut it down all winter. I mean, you can get in there, but you have to travel 35 miles in the snow past where they stopped cars from going in, because they don't plow the road up there at all.
And Wolf Creek, that closes down.
Uh-huh. And the Mount Baldy side of the Uintas.
Oh, yeah, up past Mare.
Up past Mare.
Oh, actually, they shut it right there before Bear...
Bear River Station.
Bear
Service
River
Station.
Service Station. They shut it down.
Right. They shut it down at certain times of the year. And then even when they open it up, they don't plow until Labor Day. So if there's a bunch of snow up there, even though they open up the gates, you're not getting over till they decide to plow some years, most years. You just drive up to where the snow's too deep on the road and
you're done.
A lot of it has to do with the snow removal budget, what they're willing to spend the budget on, and it's not those certain passes. Wow.
This is a lot of snow.
Snow's just as deep as the top of Bear Lake.
It is.
When we come up here in October, it snowed on us.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah, there was 2 inches of snow and slush and stuff on the road when we drove in. And then it got so warm the next day by noon. By noon, it had all melted off most places.
Tried to break into the cabin we were staying in last time we were here. Tried to open up the door. Scared the hell out of me.
Yeah, I'm hoping they were just confused and was trying to get in the wrong cabin.
Well, they didn't get in either way, so it doesn't matter. Oh, that's a nice avalanche right there. Berg.
Yeah, Jenny woke me up because someone was trying to open our cabin door that we were renting at night. By the time she got me awake and everything, they'd already had left. It was kind of weird. It's like, I'm pretty sure we rented this.
Go away.
They handed the key right to us.
Go away.
All the seasons are beautiful. This is neat. We should have done one of these driving round tables during the fall here for everybody, but...
Yeah, so they get to see how beautiful it was.
We didn't do one. We were doing a lot of hiking, a lot of stops on that. That's what we were concentrated on. We knew that there's a possibility we weren't going to be stopping a whole lot on the top, so we might as well film the drive for you guys. About 20 years ago, I worked with a guy that was from Cambodia, and I worked with him the first year that he ever saw snow in the Ogden and Salt Lake Valley of Utah, and he told me God was punishing everybody. I go, no, he punishes us every year. This is normal for here.
God is punishing.
Yeah, that's what he told me.
He didn't like the snow, huh?
Yeah, we thought God was punishing us, so. Yeah, when you've never seen it and never experienced it, I guess it's a shocker. But yeah, he punishes us every year, several times a year. This year, we've been punished a lot. We had 165% normal snow levels for the part of Utah we're from, the northern part.
Yeah, it's been hard on the animals.
Yeah, they banned shed hunting until April because they don't want to put pressure on the wildlife. They don't want people to
push them back up.
Yeah, to push them back up into the stuff they can't survive in. So... That's the first time I ever recall them banning it, but I've never really paid attention much to the shed hunting thing. My son's into shed hunting, so I know more about it now than I ever did. I don't know if we mentioned this, but we're in Colorado. Grand Mesa, Colorado. Wow. Snow is just incredibly deep.
And it's very cold. I can feel it coming up through the floorboards.
It's only 8 degrees out there.
And I thought it was cold the last time we were here.
I thought it felt great.
Just that one night. It snowed. It was cold.
Oh, yeah, the first night it snowed on us. Yeah, you're right. It was a little too cold that night. This elevation, 10,000, 11,000, it can snow any month out of the year. It can snow, you know, on July 4th, on July 24th. It can snow. I've experienced it in places like this.
We were backpacking on my birthday handful of years back, and it snowed on us in August.
Yep, August 10th. I thought it was raining, and I got outside the tent. Jenny and I backpack camped And I got out of the tent to pee, and it was snowing. It wasn't rain that I was hearing. It was snow. I was like, whoa. We were on top of the Uintas at 10,000 feet. I was a little intimidated to backpack and camp there because of the aggressive Bigfoot activity that goes on in that area. And with the Bigfoot evidence we found that day and some of the vocalizations we heard, I expected a crazy night, and it turned out to be a really mellow night. I did hear some whoops one time when I got up to pee, but they were a long distance off across the valley and up on the other mountainside away. You could hear them in the structure areas. You know, I don't know if they were Bigfoot, but they sounded like primate whoops that direction. But that's the only thing I happened all, you know, the whole time we were up there at night.
No, you slept through the horrible noises that I'd heard in the morning, just as the sun was coming up, and it was just kind of a light blue outside. It wasn't quite light outside. It sounded like a zoo with howler monkeys.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I remember you telling me about that after I woke up.
There was two calling back and forth, just right below us.
Yeah, I was expecting a night like the one up on Monte Cristo where we got no sleep.
Oh.
Our camp got harassed all night by a bear. You know, it wasn't a Bigfoot night, it was a bear night, but I was expecting something similar up there. Except for I was expecting maybe getting harassed by a Bigfoot, because the footprints, the hair, the vocalizations we heard that day near where we were camping.
Plus the multiple times that it had screamed and growled at us
on previous expeditions.
Yeah.
That was in Yellowstone Canyon on the Uintas. That's a creepy canyon.
Yeah, it sure is.
Creepy stuff has happened to us there.
Yeah, the last time we were there, just this past summer, the tree got ripped down.
Right? And we heard those vocalizations up on the mountain at the mouth of the canyon coming in. And
I know, that was
we
scary.
Thought they were people at first, and then we were like, well, where's their cars? Where's their flashlight? Where's their fire? It's in the middle of the night.
Midnight.
Where's their motorcycle? Where's their ATV? You know, what's going on?
And yeah, it was bizarre.
They're in the, you know, they're off trail, and they were hollering back and forth at each other saying, hey! Hey, you know.
And they also were making hoo, hoo noises.
It was weird, and they kept coming down the mountain closer and closer to us, and sometimes they would direct the vocalizations at us, most of the time back and forth to each other. And there was a...
And they were getting closer and closer.
We're looking in the direction of Montrose. I told you guys earlier on this drive about the window peeking Bigfoot, and there's been a couple of Bigfoot sightings down there on the edges of the town and the farming communities and stuff. But yeah, we were talking earlier how a lot of weird stuff happens when we camp on Yellowstone Canyon. Rarely do we camp in the Uintas, in the Yellowstone Canyon area, that something that's
creepy.
Yeah, Bigfoot style that we suspect happens. We find footprints. That's where we found the nasty wads of hair next to some footprints. And
it's uncomfortable there. We go there because it's such a good spot, but to be there is very uncomfortable.
I kind of want to flip the car in the direction of the Montrose area and stuff. Look at...
Down in the valley.
How far down you have to get into the valley and stuff. So yeah, there's Bigfoot sightings up here, and then down there every once in a while there is. And, you know, suspect the Bigfoot, especially in the summertime, are probably more interested in the Mesa than down in the valley. But who knows? Maybe they spend more time in the valley. There's also the church camp Bigfoot sightings and stuff down there. And well, some of the stuff that we've found on other expeditions that we were just talking about will include some of the photos or maybe even videos at the end of this.
From Yellowstone Canyon.
Right, from Yellowstone Canyon. Creepy place. And I think the creepiness may have to do with the Bigfoot factor there.
There's Indian burial grounds there as well.
There was old Spanish mines back there that they enslaved Indians to mine 300-400 years ago, and a lot of juju going on in that area.
Mm-hmm. You can feel it.
It's amazing some of the places that people used to mine gold are also Bigfoot places, like Jarbidge, Silverton.
Uintas.
Yeah, the Uintas.
In the middle of the mountains.
Right. And the, let's not forget Deadwood.
Oh, yeah.
Deadwood's on the edge of the River of No Return National Forest.
Yeah, the wilderness. That's really pretty. Territory.
We didn't make it into that area last year. It's been going on 2 years since we've made it into the River of No Return wilderness area. And
we went last year.
Yeah, we went in 2015. Yeah, we ended up in Oregon, Washington, California, Colorado. A lot this last year, aside from our local North Utah and Southern Idaho Bigfoot expeditions. We also made it almost all the way to Yellowstone National Park Bigfooting. We made it right to the park boundaries and stuff this year.
Yeah, we went into the free side. Mm-hmm. That we wanted to get back in that canyon.
Cave Falls area.
Yeah, Cave Falls.
And like we said before, I believe there's over 300 acres lakes up here, 250 or whatever it is, a lot of lakes. But in the wintertime, they're frozen over and snowed over, and a lot of them we just can't get into. They don't plow the dirt roads, so
yep.
We're mostly limited to pavement.
This year, we are just kind of checking snow levels.
And if we can find some good places to hike partway down on the Mesa, at the edge of the snow line, we'll do some hiking and looking for some Bigfoot evidence. We always find ourselves at the edge of the snow line year round. I think that's the big best Bigfooting places is at the edge of the snow line. Follow it like the animals do. Definitely places you don't want to go off the road.
No, that's steep.
Yup. There's places out near Silverton that are just white knuckler frightening.
Yeah.
And Jenny was begging me to let her drive. Because, of course, you're going to trust your own driving more than someone else's when it's that scary. And I'm like, no, I don't want to be a passenger. I want control of the vehicle. Yeah, it's funny. Some of the people that live in Silverton were telling us that those roads in and out of Silverton have caused a lot of divorces. They are frightening. Because, I mean, it's just... I mean, it's the white line of the road is the edge of the road, and then it's straight down cliffs where you know you go off. There's no chance you go off.
You're done.
Mm-hmm. I know, and I'm sure the locals don't like driving behind me up there. I drive like 5-10 under the speed limit because I'm scared. And Jenny's... And even though I'm doing 5-10 under the speed limit, Jenny's still like, can I drive now?
My turn. Come on.
Yeah, my brother and my stepmom, both before I went to Glacier the first time, was telling me how scary the driving to the Sun Road is. And everything, and so I was expecting a terrifying experience from what they were saying. Maybe it's just they're extremely afraid of heights, but I thought it was mellow. I mean, I was like, oh my gosh, don't let my brother, my stepmom on those Silverton roads, because they will have a heart attack if
yeah.
if those glacier roads scared them.
Yeah,
they don't put any type of guardrails. So, you go off. There's no second chance. And they don't put the guardrails because they get in the way when they plow the roads in the wintertime. So, they just go without the guardrails. At least on the Glacier Road, the guardrail, they make like a 3 or 4 foot tall stone wall as a guardrail the whole way up and down, so you have that. I don't know, I had that sense of security that wall would stop us from going off.
Sure is pretty though.
Yes, it
really
is.
Really nice.
Okay, we're getting back down into civilization, and we're gonna go look for places to hike today and tomorrow, and look for Bigfoot evidence. If we find anything worthy, you guys watch for those videos. We'll put out those videos outside of our driving roundtable videos. But I hope you enjoyed this driving roundtable drive of the Grand Mesa, Colorado. I consider it a Bigfoot sighting hotspot. Just about a dozen Bigfoot sightings that I know personally on and around this mesa, and I'm sure there's a lot more that don't go reported, if there's that many reported. But this is one of the areas that we'll come to from time to time and see if we can find anything. See, we're on the edge of the snow level now, so we're getting into some places where we can hike around and see if we can find anything that looks like it might belong to Bigfoot.
If you have a report, send it to us.
Keep on watching. We're going to keep on squatching.